then.
Chat with Traders, episode 82.
The biggest secret of the best traders in the world is that they're just like everyone else. However, they've worked hard to learn the markets and discover what works and what doesn't. But how can you hear about these journeys and get in on the strategies and tactics they use? You can do it by listening to Chat with Traders. Here's your host, Aaron Fifield.
Sponsoring this episode is Real Vision TV, the world's only video-on-demand channel for finance. This means at any time you can tune in to watch detailed interviews and presentations from extremely bright people who know money and markets. I'm talking the best analysts, fund managers, economists, traders, and investors all in one place. So put an end to there's quote-unquote nothing to watch by going to realvisiontv.com/traders and get yourself set up with a free 7-day trial of Real Vision TV. Again, that's realvisiontv.com/traders for a free 7-day trial to start streaming now. Okay, what's up? How you doing? This week, for the second time on Chat with Traders, my guest is Morad, or better known as Futures Trader 71. As you could imagine, FT is a futures trader. He's also very short term and has been trading for around about 16 years now. During this time, he was the founder of a successful prop firm and more recently has started a brokerage, Stage 5 Trading. First time around, on episode 37, we spoke extensively about FT's path of becoming a trader, market profile and volume profile, and creating a legacy. This time, we spoke about all new topics. For example, how to learn a new skill, how to measure your progress besides P&L, how to remove attachment to the outcome, how FT uses a regressive risk management strategy, and plenty more too. This is a really big episode and FT shares a ton of practical info. So if you need to, you know, listen 2-3 times and take notes as you're going. Actually, I'll also just mention quickly, there were a few minor glitches in the audio as we were recording. Please just roll with it. They only last a few seconds at most. Anyway, here we go. This is my second interview with Futures Trader 71.
All in all, everything's really good. I'm very happy.
Oh, awesome. That's good to hear. We got a really great response from your last interview, so I'm sure this one will be well received also.
Hope so.
Yeah. So anyway, I've put together a few notes from my side. I think some of the topics I'd like to talk to you about, which I've mentioned to you on Twitter. So pretty much trader development, risk management, managing drawdowns, tips for linking up with a really good broker. And I've also opened a Facebook group. So anyone listening to this, if you want to join, chatwithtraders.com/Facebook, completely free to join, of course. I posted in there that I was having you back on the podcast and if there were any questions that some of the members would like to ask you. So I've got a few members that have come, I've got a few questions that have come out of the Facebook group as well. So we'll tackle those as we go. So
I just requested to join that group.
Ah, nice. Good to have you in there. So, all right, well, let's roll into it. So if anyone hasn't heard our first interview, which was on episode 37. So if you want to check that out, chatwithtraders.com/37. You guys can go and listen to the first time we spoke. For anyone who hasn't heard that yet or who might be unfamiliar with who you are, FT, could you just give us a real quick sort of rundown on who you are, what you're all about, and then we'll take it from there.
So the 30-second elevator pitch is... I've been trading professionally for about 16 years now. I started out in equities as a SOS trader, as a SOS bandit, so to speak, and moved to futures. I started out in Florida, in Boca Raton, and moved up to Chicago to trade futures at a prop group in the Board of Trade, and essentially my entire trading career has been in a group setting or in a professional environment. And now I've moved away from being in a professional environment to creating a professional environment. I was running a prop shop at the Board of Trade since 2004, from 2004 to about 2010. And then from there, I decided to look online and start working on other things. And since then, I started a brokerage with a partner. The brokerage is called Stage 5 Trading. And my focus within the brokerage is not to sell the brokerage or anything, but to focus on trader development. In other words, my goal is to bring as much as possible the experience I had as a prop shop operator, and I was very successful doing that, to the retail public. So I'm pushing back. My goal is to push back against anyone that is in the business of just signing traders on, giving them the maximum leverage and kind of, you know, shooting them off and letting them sink while they work on the next candidate. My goal is to help the industry by helping traders stay as traders for as long as possible. I'm not always going to be successful, but I believe slowing traders down and helping them understand risk and so on will help them get closer to achieving their goal of being a trader. So a lot of that, there's a lot of misinformation in our business, as I'm sure you've done so many interviews. I'm sure you've come across people who've said that before. There's a lot of misinformation, a lot of undue strain on traders trying to make it. And there's this veil of secrecy that I don't think should exist, because it didn't exist in my prop shop and we were successful. We're not automated traders or anything like that, so we're not giving away any secret sauce. So I feel like the best thing a trader can have is a structured, dedicated community that they can trust and interact with, and that'll help them move along, as opposed to being with a one-on-one mentor who may or may not know what they're doing. So that's where I am now. And I'm moving, now that the brokerage is set up and it's running, I'm moving towards creating a substantial course that takes someone who's coming into futures or trading in general and carries them through the process of understanding all the important pieces to actually come out as a professional trader on the other side. So my goal is to now take those who want to pursue this and provide a standardized process for coming out the other end, almost like someone who has, you know, an engineering degree or something. There's a minimum amount of knowledge that they should have, and that's the next big project I'm working on. So there's a lot going on. Just the short story is there's probably too much going on for my own health, but I enjoy it all.
Always good to keep busy though, that's right. So one of the things I didn't pick up on last time when I had you on the podcast, which I wanted to ask you about this time around, is the story of the Sows Bandits. I mean, they were quite well known when they were around. Can you give us a little bit of background, a little bit of context around who were the Sows Bandits and what did they do?
Sure. So the Sows Bandits started way before my time. They started around 1990, and it was generally there was a group headed by someone named Sheldon with Datex Securities, and what this group did was, for the first time, they managed to get level two access, meaning they can see the full depth of the market on the various NASDAQ stocks, and they could see what the institutions are bidding and offering on any given stock. So depending on which stock is in play, most common stocks that were in play at the time were Microsoft and JDSU and tech companies like that. And what they did was they found a way to use what's called the SOS system. The SOS stands for a small order entry system, and it was designed to fill small lot orders as opposed to going to a normal a clear market maker like Island or what we call an ECN to fill normal size lots, except we were trading anywhere between 10 and 40,000 shares per order. So it was an exploit of this system, And what happened with the Daytech group is they figured out this way of getting quicker quotes than the traditional method by using the SOS system and being able to route these orders across the board as opposed to having to go through ARCA, INCA, Island, and so on, this a specific clearer. And so they exploited this and then built an entire business around it. I mean, there was a point where their shop had hundreds of traders in it. I was not in that process. I was still, that was way before my time. But in 2000, I came across several people who were incubated in that process, were trading actually out of in Arizona, and had moved to Florida, to Boca Raton, Florida. And so they were trading the same process. It was a room of about 25 traders, some of whom were making ridiculous money. I mean, the Daytech group in general, there were many, many traders in there making over $500,000 a year doing this brainless manual ARB, just buying in front of size, selling in front of size. And that's what we were doing for a while. So you would have a screen that had maybe 10 products, 10 boxes, level 2 boxes on it, of various stocks, and you are just constantly monitoring for size coming in and pushing the book, you know, an institution coming in and just putting, you know, a massive order of, say, 10 million shares to buy, and then they start to move that order up because they needed to fill it, and you would just be buying in front of them and then selling to them as they upticked. And when they upticked in what was called a teeny, which was 1/8 of a dollar, which is 12.5 cents. So that made the bid offer spread really large on, say, 10,000 shares. And that caused some guys to, I mean, some of the guys I traded with had, you know, not that this is typical, but they would have, you know, a couple of $100,000 days doing this. And so when I joined, I was trading 200 share lots. It took me a while to figure out what was going on. I had no idea what a bid is or an offer is. And by the time I had it figured out, 9/11 had come around, and also the market went from teenies to decimals. So you went from a 12.5 cent spread to a penny spread, and you're doing this ARB, right? So you're doing this, you're basically acting as a market maker. So all of a sudden, a lot of these traders just fell out because there was no edge anymore. So with high frequency and the penny spread, that ended up drying up, and it certainly dried up with 9/11 when the market was closed for 2 months. So I took what was left in my trading account, which I ran up from around $54,000 to a lot more, and I took that and I bought a home with it. I thought trading was done with. I bought a home in West Palm Beach and was looking for something else to do when I found out that there were still some opportunities in the equities side. And I joined Schoenfeld in Boca Raton and traded with them for a while, and then found out about futures. And ended up, a friend of mine and I ended up jumping into a car and driving for 20 hours overnight to Chicago to find a spot in a prop shop to trade futures. So my stint in the SOS environment lasted about a year, a little over a year.
Okay.
And it wasn't something that I could tell from the very beginning that it was all based on how much money was being made. There was really no, compared to the investing and the personal trading that I was doing before it, it just, you could tell that it had no sustainable value overall. But as I said, there were a lot of Porsches and Ferraris and so on parked on the outside, and there was the allure of showing up. I mean, my first day showing up, I sat behind someone who was up $18,500 in the first hour. You know, you can't, it's hard to resist that. But SOS was something that that was cheap, and it was an exploit that, just like all exploits in the financial market, it lasted for a while. A bunch of people benefited from it, and that edge disappeared.
Yeah, yeah, okay. Now, that was really interesting to get your take on that FT. And the SOS Bandits, I noticed they're actually really heavily profiled in Scott Patterson's book, Dark Pools. So if anyone listening is keen to hear more about that, that's a good place to look. And also, if you want to hear more about FT's story about how he came into this business, check out chatwithtraders.com/37 for our first interview. So one of the topics I'd really like to dig into now is trader development. Let's start by talking about what's the process of how to actually learn a new skill. I mean, I think this is a big problem that a lot of traders actually have is knowing the process of how to learn a new skill. Because when we're in school, we have a structured learning environment. But trading, we're pretty much on our own with no structured learning environment. What's your take on this? How should we go about learning a new skill, just taking it back to basics?
That was the biggest puzzle I had to face when I was in a prop shop in futures, because that's the first time when I got exposed to having to be responsible for another trader, to train another trader for a portion of their profits once they made the turn. And it was a big part of my preparation for my own prop shop. How do we learn most effectively? I did a lot of sports growing up. I played a lot of soccer. You guys call it football, and basketball. And it's pretty much when you're looking at trading. And by the way, when I was hiring, I always favored those who are in a sport on a competitive level. Actually, I always favored anyone that was doing something on a competitive level, even if it's chess or music or whatever. These all require the same level of focused, deliberate, repetitive consistency. And this is the challenge, the biggest challenge that I see with traders, right? So traders like to come in and they want to take every ounce of knowledge they can get, and then they try this and dabble in that and try that and dabble in this, and there's really no measured sort of consistent repeating process which is required for the skill to eventually show that trader what works, what doesn't, what their weaknesses are, what their strengths are. And that's really important, as it's an important part of the process, because you want to play to your strengths. Like, my strength is reading order flow. I cannot trade just around order flow. So I create a hypothesis on the day, several of them, but I'm really focused on order flow to the point that if my hypothesis is wrong, the damage is not that great, and I can always improve my position in the market. But to answer your question, what traders need to know is that this is not going to be easy. And I know that it sells more books and courses and tools and indicators to say all you have to do is install this, or all you have to do is read this amazing book and you'll have it figured out. But the process usually requires longer than you think, is more expensive than you think, and requires a lot more dedication than you think. And you will learn a lot more about yourself when you go to trade than you think you will. And in the end, the thing I always told my traders when I was interviewing them is, I can't guarantee your success, but I can guarantee that no matter what, when you walk away, when you come out the other end, whether you didn't make it and had to be cut from the prop shop or made it and passed your agreement and are independent, you will know yourself a lot better, you know. But the process has to be has to focus on the stages of competence, okay? And it's understood that everybody comes in and they think They think they know what they need to know, or they think they can acquire it by reading books or looking at blogs and so on. But what they don't know is what they don't know. Like they have no idea what lies beyond their field of view. And so what you need in that situation, first and foremost, is someone else who knows that you can trust. And that someone else can be a person or a group, preferably a group, who can help you expand on the knowledge without adding too much baggage, too much fluff, and without misleading you. And it's very hard to do in the financial, in the trading business, because there's a lot out there that is very misleading. There are a lot of mentors who have never traded professionally. There are a lot of program or indicator or system makers who have not seen success in that system and therefore are selling it, things like that. I've seen a lot of things which I was completely oblivious to before 2009 when I came online and started to look around. And that's why my focus is to cut through all that and kind of I see a great benefit to just saying, here's what it's going to take. It's very ugly, you know, it seems very difficult to overcome at first, but in the end, it's all contingent on your ability to recognize within yourself what needs to change and to make that change. So to answer your question, you know, what does it take? It takes a little bit of help and the understanding that much of the time that you will focus will probably be on learning a trading system or an edge that'll make money. But really, what it's going to take for you to make money is not some trading system or an indicator. It is your ability to execute on something that has an edge in the market. I don't know if I answered your question there.
Yeah, no, I think that was a really good answer. And I mean, we're going to go a little deeper into this as well. So how can we avoid spending time on things that don't matter? Like, how can we be aware or conscious of the things we're spending time on that they're actually the right things that we should be spending time on? Like, how do we know where to funnel our focus?
So that's the part where it helps to have a group, to be part of a group, or to have someone who has some tenure or experience in the market. They help narrow that field down for you. I'll give you an example. I have never, I had almost a 92% success rate in my prop shop, and I define success as a trader completing their 3-year contract and leaving on a positive with positive equity, including membership. That's my measure of success. And my job was to kind of corral that energy. You know, someone comes in and they think, oh my God, if I do this, oh, I noticed that this happens, and only if I can throw a 500 lot in the bonds to make millions of dollars in one day. No, we're going to focus on just this today. Today, you're going to focus on getting in long and scratching the trade. That's all you're going to do. You need to build trust in your ability to take yourself out when things aren't working right. You need to build trust in your ability to react to the market without emotion or with as little emotion as possible, as opposed to going out and finding the best curve-fitted, optimized moving average possible for the product that you're trading. You know, to me, that is not something you can grow from. I think you had an interview with Jeff Davis, who's a friend of mine, great guy, and he said a lot of the exact right things as far as, you know, just focus on, just push, technically push enough to find something that suits your personality that you can then look for an edge in. In other words, test it out, whether it's by clicking in a simulator and penalizing your exits to make up for the, you know, unrealistic fills or whatever, but push to the point where you can simply feel comfortable doing something, doing and living with it. And then once you've done that, now you can refine that particular thing. And it could be as simple as, you know, I will trade with fibs, or I will take the, you know, the reversal trade after the market opens, and that's my trade of the day. If you can master that one trade, or, you know, three or four signals, three or four setups, if you can just become the supreme commander of those signals, I have money that's going to stand behind you and say, okay, let's turn it up. Let's go from trading two lots to trading 10s, 15s, 20s, 500 if we need to. And that's the way to make money. It's better than this process that I see traders go through where they try what Aaron's last guest is doing. Then they try the next guest, and then they get on chat with traders later and decide automation is maybe their thing. And then they fall back. Maybe I should test a moving average crossover. This guy's using stochastics, so let me look at that. And what you end up with is a whole world of people, of traders, who have invested a tremendous amount of time, a commodity that we cannot recover, just bouncing from one thing to the next, all of which could work, all of which might fail. But they have spent so much time at the beginning of the learning curve over and over and over that they have not been able to master that one thing. So to answer your question, if you find yourself constantly changing and changing and changing the approach that you're taking to the market, then you know something is wrong. For me, it was scalping, you know, order flow. And when that didn't work anymore, I started to look at pretty much everything just like everybody else. But then I started to look at volume profiling. I went from market profiling to volume profiling. And I started to notice, with detailed notes, I started to notice that there are certain things that happen consistently just enough for me to be able to exploit them with size. And if I can exploit them with size and keep my targets modest, my stops modest, I'm able to create a positive outcome overall, a positive expectancy, and all that's left is for me to be confident enough in my numbers to put on a good amount of size. And that's where the money's made. The money's not in buying the low, selling the high short, and buying the low back. I think that's a fantasy. The money is in grabbing small, definable chunks of the rotations that happen throughout the day in the time frame that is suited to you, that you feel comfortable in. Some people feel comfortable in a 15-minute time frame. Some just want to be in and out in a matter of a few minutes. Just whatever is comfortable for you, the market's there to offer you the opportunity to make money or lose money, depending on, you know, whether that time frame is in favor or not. I know that's a lengthy answer, but I'm combining a lot of different experiences that I've had, especially with our current clients in our brokerage. And my focus is always to not say, hey, look at this additional thing, look at this additional thing. My focus is constantly to, no, cut it down. No, you don't need 12 setups. You need maybe 3 or 4, maybe 5, you know, become incredibly good at these 5 setups, whatever they are, and that's where your deliberate, focused practice should lie. That's where all of your journaling, tracking, and statistics should be built off of, these 3-4 things that you're exploiting on a daily basis, and that's the way to know if you're completely lost. How do you narrow down the field? You narrow it down by knowing that I cannot be like a weather vane, just switching directions depending on the prevailing wind for that day. If you're doing that, then your chances are you're losing something that's very, very important. It's not the money in your account, it's the time that slips by and reduces your chances of being able to make the turn and make a living at this in a reasonable amount of time.
Mm. I really like your emphasis on the time there, FT. I think that's a really important point to make. One of the other things you said in your response there was, you know, finding an approach that fits your personality. And this is something we hear quite often, especially on the podcast. From speaking with a number of listeners, I know this is actually something they struggle with. They're like, well, how do I know if something fits my personality? Like, how do I find that? How do I know if this approach is a good fit for me? Because the chances are, even if you do find an approach that is a good fit for you, you're still not going to be consistently profitable with it right away. It's still going to take some time. So, I mean, do you have any tips and pointers for how someone can identify when a strategy or an approach to trading is well suited to them?
Okay, that's a fair question. To answer that, I would have to look at the specific person, but let's take you for example. You started out wanting to trade. You deposited, I believe it was $5,000 into an account, and you wanted to learn how to trade. And that led you to exploring, how do I trade? And I believe that led you to this broadcast, right? Which is a very, very successful broadcast. Is that, do I have the history right?
Essentially, yeah.
Okay. So, Aaron, how would you like to trade wheat using moon cycles? How does that sound to you?
Yeah, no, that's not appealing to me.
Okay. That doesn't suit your personality. How would you like to trade corn using the price of sugar? That may be something you'll be interested to look into, as long as there's a correlation, maybe not. But if you do the study and find that correlation, you'll suddenly find yourself, it's more of a feeling, you find yourself absorbed by this approach. For me, it was, you know, the NASDAQ is moving up, the S&P is sluggish, the Dow is starting to move up, I'm buying the S&P, I'm ready to sell the NASDAQ if it doesn't continue and the S&P starts moving down. And I'm going to do that 500-600 times a day, trading anywhere between 2,000 to 3,000 round turns a day. That's all I did when I started trading futures. And that appealed to me. It was quick. If I was wrong, I was immediately out. But over time, it didn't feel right anymore, because it seemed like I was taking tremendous risk for very little return. So in my process of exploring other things, I felt that, you know, fibs may be the thing to look at. And I got excited about studying fibs and Elliott waves and Drummond geometry and Gartley's. And I've looked at all these things, but there was always this sense that I don't get it. This makes no sense. Or floor pivots, floor trader pivots. I'm sure you've heard of those. The mathematically based numbers that come off of yesterday's open, high, low, close that are computed and used for today's trading. That mathematically, that sounded okay. But to me, I wanted, my personality is such that I wanted to understand what makes the market. What is it trying to do when it's moving up? What is it trying to do when it's moving down? And why does it sometimes move down with no volume and sometimes it moves down with a lot of volume? And so organizing the information in a way that explained these things that appealed to me gave me a home, right? So I looked for an explanation using market profile, but market profile uses 30-minute time slots, doesn't take a volume into account at all. But when I started to switch, and this was by accident, my trading software, which was a CQG integrated client, had this option to turn on these volume bars, and I turned them on. And in fact, on my ladder, on my Xtrader, my TTX Trader Pro, the ladder had these bars on the side that showed you how much traded at each one of the prices up and down the ladder. And I started to notice, as the market moved towards prices that had very little volume, it tended to bounce the first time as a push to those prices. It would take a small bounce before it failed, and it would push through, and then it would pull back to that low volume price before it continued. And so I started to look at, what if I looked at things from the perspective of volume per price over time? So I can see yesterday's volume per price, last week's, last month's, you know, everything since the last swing low or swing high. And that made a lot of sense to me. And so that became the thing that I got excited about, and I threw everything else away because that made sense to me. It suited my personality. I had this particular curiosity. Whereas we have other traders within stage five, for example, who trade tremendous size, who are going basically by a stochastic type of read on multiple time frames. That's, you know, if I talk to them about volume profiling, they would get glassy-eyed and start to yawn. They've found what they like or what makes sense to them, what excites them, and they've spent time focusing on those things, deliberately testing and checking and playing back bar by bar what is happening as the day develops over time. And pretty much every trader I know that has gotten anywhere with trading, and I've known some really big ones here in Chicago, they have generally come from the field of, I trade by feel, didn't do very well, then decided, forget the feel, I'm going to go back and just go bar by bar by bar and study what the market is doing, whether it's pattern trading, candlestick, using some sort of an indicator, and so on. Each one of those people got to the point where they suffered enough with the poor outcome of their effort to go back and say, let me dig down and find just what I need. Just basically bare bones, cut back to exactly the minimum amount of information I need to make a decision. And it boils down to, what is the statistical probability of something continuing after a specific event? You know, we have a large bar, an expansion of range on an expansion of volume, then every time that's happened, or most predominantly when that happens, we generally get a continuation, another expanded bar on higher volume, but not as high as the first time it happened. And those are what I call impulsive and continuation trades. I can hardly catch the impulsive trade because it happens without warning. That's big money coming in and out of the market. But I can certainly try to do something with the continuation trade. And a continuation trade has a 78% probability of, if it's an impulsive move up, then a continuation trade generally has a 78% probability of testing, after pulling back, of testing that first high. So imagine the market moving up all of a sudden with great strength, and then it pulls back, creates this flag, and 78% of the time in the S&P minis, it will retest that last high, the original push. You know, that's something I can really get into. So it's really a function of trying a bunch of things and then focusing on shedding everything else. Whereas most traders spend a lot of time just accumulating and accumulating and accumulating and never really shedding. They're looking at so much on their charts, it's impossible to make a decision without second guessing it, you know? So that's where the words find something that you're comfortable with basically essentially means, sure, go out there and explore, but eventually narrow it down to something that you really like and you know, make it as simple as you can.
All right, team, here's just a quick word for our sponsor of this episode, Real Vision TV, a truly badass video on demand channel for finance. For some background, Real Vision TV was founded by global macro trader Rual Powell, who you'll remember from episode 79. He was phenomenal. And 30-year finance vet Grant Williams. The two started Real Vision TV because mainstream financial media is, you know, let's just be honest here, it's pretty lame. It's soundbites, it's surface-level thinking, it's sensationalism. So if you take all of that and flip it on its head, then this is what you get. Real Vision TV, which is high-value content with depth and no bias or agenda. Once you tune in, there is literally hours upon hours of presentations and interviews with billion-dollar fund managers, investors, traders, economists, and analysts who cover all asset classes, even real estate and Bitcoin. Plus, there's new videos being added each week without fail. Now, if you'd like to take a look, and I obviously wouldn't be saying this if I didn't think you should, go to realvisiontv.com/traders and pick up a free 7-day trial for unlimited access. So go there now and get your binge watching fix with Real Vision TV. Again, that's realvisiontv.com/traders. Okay, so just to take it the next step and to continue on this point, do you have any suggestions for how developing traders may be able to monitor their progress? Because the reason I ask that is because, like I mentioned just before, usually when you come to start trading a new strategy or take a new approach to markets, there is inconsistency in the beginning and often for the first few years. So is there another way to measure your progress besides just P&L?
Great question. I am very anti P&L as a measure of progress. And the example of that is, if you look at any profession in which there's a pretty sizable demand, meaning there's a good payout. Think of a cardiologist or cardiosurgeon or a brain surgeon. You know, there's a high demand for that kind of skill set, and so we pay a lot for it. Imagine if you needed brain surgery, and your surgeon happened to have measured all of his progress throughout med school, his residency, his or her residency and fellowship and everything else, was simply making the decisions on your healthcare based on dollars they earned. So I am going to do this particular procedure, even though you may not need it, because it gives me the maximum profitability. Or I can take care of the same issue by putting you on a course of antibiotics, which will make me $100 instead of $100,000, but may save you from going through risky surgery. So if we measure everything by P&L, we find that the world would be in a much worse place. And that is exactly what happens with trading. If you're sitting there, if you're a trader who's listening to this and you spend much of your day trading while your P&L is flashing on your screen, you are essentially putting yourself in a situation where it's very, very, very difficult not to start trading that P&L. In other words, your trading decisions are not based on market behavior, market structure, and the auction. They start to become something that is based on how you feel about the amount of money you've made, or how you feel about how much money you've lost. You notice that most traders who are trading within their plan, they trade very little. There's a lot of space in between trades because they're waiting, they're being patient enough to wait for the next setup. Traders who are losing money generally have their P&L on their screen and generally are trading minutes apart. It's unrealistic that on good days they have to wait a half hour, hour, maybe 2 hours in between trades, but on bad days they're waiting 2-3 minutes, and that's because they're measuring their performance with their P&L. You want to measure your performance, you have to track a little bit more information. Mainly, you need to track your errors. That's a huge thing. I have shown in the past, of course, on this broadcast, we don't have any visuals, but I have taken someone's live trades and someone who was very diligent about recording each trade and whether it fit within the plan or if it's an error trade. Error trades are things like trades that where you took a long when you should have taken a short. You have fear of missing out, FOMO. You've chased the market instead of waiting for it to get to your price. taking someone else's trade. In other words, there was no trade for you, but someone said they just got long, that person made money on the last trade in your chat room or on Twitter or whatever, so you just decided to jump in with them. That's an error trade. A technical error trade, meaning you clicked the wrong button or something. And there are two others. And if you track those errors and you take those errors out of your performance, you would be absolutely astounded as to how much those errors cost. So your goal as a trader is not to look at how much money did I make on a daily basis. I mean, it's nice. That's why we're here. We're here to make money overall. But you're not just like the doctor or the surgeon or the engineer. Your next trading decision is irrelevant of what your P&L is. In fact, your current trade is absolutely discrete in nature, meaning it has no relation to the prior trade. So your P&L is creating this artificial link in between all of these trades that are completely unrelated. Whether you made money on the long last time does not mean you'll make money on this long this time, because the short may be in order. So it's better to track, first and foremost, is your execution in line with your plan? So you need to start tracking your errors, and you need to start tracking how each trade has performed on its own. And the way I like to track a series of trades is not through overall P&L, but through expectancy. So we're looking at essentially what the average gain or loss is over a large sample. And the minimum sample size for anyone to consider whether or not they have an edge is probably about 50 trades, the absolute minimum. And so you're stringing together this expectancy, and we're looking for expectancy in terms of ticks or points instead of dollars. Let's keep dollars out of this. Let's keep dollars to bookkeeping on the weekends. But during the trading week, you want to track, you know, here's my plan. Here's how I executed on my plan. I executed every trade on my plan. I executed 1 out of 5 trades. I executed 5 out of 5 trades. Who knows? But you want to focus on how are you interacting relative to what you plan to do. That's so much more important, because your exercise, your attention to become a professional is on the moment-to-moment execution, not the fact that you rode, you know, a 10-point run in the S&P on a 12-point range day and you're a superstar. To those people, I say, watch out. Watch your risk. You're about to get whacked by the market, because that sort of thing gives people false confidence. But if you can come to me and say, even if you're trading for me, and you came to me and said, look, I lost $5,000 this month, but here's my log, and I see that you have essentially followed your plan for the most part, and you have very few errors, I would say, great job, keep going. Because it just means that you're executing your plan, but your plan does not have an edge for that particular period of time. And every edge disappears and reappears and disappears and reappears. There are times when the market's in balance. There are times when the market's trending, and you may be someone who has a plan that has more emphasis on balance than trend. And so you will lose. It's kind of like an automated trading system. Everybody has an edge for a period, and everybody has a drawdown for a period. It's just the nature of the business. Does that make sense?
Absolutely. No, that was an awesome answer. I really liked how you explained that. And this next question might sort of prompt for a similar kind of answer, but I'm going to ask it anyway, and you can give me your take on it. Traders are often attached to the outcome. Now, that's quite a problem. What would you say about this?
So, yeah, huge issue. I know there are some psychologists out there who probably focus all their attention, trader psychologists will focus their attention on this. So attachment, and I try not to get spiritual on you, attachment is is a key source of suffering. And I'm not a Buddhist or anything like that, but it is true. In trading, let's take the typical new recruit to a prop shop, to my prop shop, okay? So I put up $25,000 in futures for the next trader into a sub-account. I go out to through this and do this extensive process of selecting a new trader. A lot goes into that. And then that trader comes in and starts to go through a course of understanding what a futures contract is, how to create an index, all this theory. And then very quickly, that's about a week, and then very quickly they switch over into a simulator and understanding all the different order types and everything else. So still a technical part of the process that takes about, so we're about 3 weeks in. Then that trader spends about a month on sim, and the month on sim is really dedicated to the process of watching the market tick by tick by tick from the time they get in till the time they leave, documenting what they've done. And they develop an understanding of how their particular market flows. And all traders start out on a thin index like the Dow, something slow enough and so on to follow along. But I never tell them, no, you need to trade a Dow, or no, you need to trade crude, no, you're going to do the Euro stocks or the DAX or whatever. It's really a function of looking at different markets and deciding which one suits your personality, sort of, which one is not boring you to death, really. And so once they've done that, they've pretty much accumulated all the technical skills that they need and have a false confidence in their edge. And I know this. And so they start to trade live. It takes the trader a process of burning through. Out of the $25,000, they'll burn through about $18,000 in general, somewhere between $15,000 and $20,000, so we'll average about $18,000 in losses. As they work out their issues and so on. So the technical side of things really gets all wrapped up in about 5 to 6 weeks. And then they spend the next 4 to 6 months getting over the personality psychological problem. The great majority of the cost of backing a trader or turning a trader from an absolute novice who has no idea what a trade is to someone who's clicking every day and consistently seeing a positive outcome on most days, 80% of the time is spent on the psychological personality issues. And a huge chunk of that 80% is the attachment problems, what I call the attachment problem. It is the fact that we are unable to let go of what has happened and to look at it for what it is. So the fact that you lost money yesterday because yesterday was a choppy day or whatever, and it wasn't your type of day, you have to look at that in its own box. And you have to take that box and kind of put it away and look at today as its own discrete new session. Just like you have to look at every trade today from trade to trade to trade as its own discrete outcome. And each discrete outcome has an equal chance of either winning or losing, 50-50. Even though you might have a 70% win rate, even though you might have a profit factor of 1.5 to 1 or something, it doesn't matter. The very next trade has an outcome that is absolutely unknowable. And I think I talked about this in our first session, but it's so hard for people to see that. I'll give you an example. Imagine if Messi, every time he would go to the goal and he would miss, he would take a shot at the goal and he would miss. Imagine if for the rest of the game, he is measuring his next shot at the goal based on the last shot. Okay, I went too far to the right. Now I'm going to shoot to the left. And I'm doing it with a heartache, and I'm doing it with anger and resentment, and I'm disappointed in myself. Just imagine if that happened every time he kicked the ball. He would be a terrible player, just as there are many, many terrible players in many, many sports who are angry at the fact that they missed an easy shot, or they should have smashed the ball and they end up hitting it outside of the line in the tennis court, or whatever. What you have to do as a trader is the same thing that you have to do as an athlete, and that is to recognize that every contact you have with whatever it is, the market, the ball, every contact is discrete. Its outcome is absolutely judged within itself. And that is so hard for people to get. Now, don't mistake this with the fact that you need an overall edge, that if you string all of these discrete outcomes together, you get a sample of n sample of data, and the overall outcome of that entire sample has to be positive. It has to be profitable. In other words, you can't have a system that loses 70% of the time and makes one-to-one profit to risk, profit to stop, and expect somehow to make money. It's mathematically impossible. But if you know that, hey, my very next trade has absolutely no connection with my very last trade, then I can trade freely. I can just look at the market for what it is right now, and that's detachment. And so detachment should not be mistaken with carelessness. Like when I say, hey, Aaron, you need to be detached from the outcome of what's happening. It doesn't mean that, you know what, forget about risk. I don't care. I don't care what happens. That's not detachment. That's just carelessness. That's foolishness. Detachment just simply means I am not defined by this trade. I am not defined by a series of today's trades or this week's worth of trades or this month's worth of trades. That is not who I am. I'm not a good trader just because I had a good month. I'm not a bad trader because I had a poor month. I am just trading my plan. And my plan says that if I follow the process and follow my risk rules, the overall and the overarching outcome is going to be positive. And so if you start to decide, and that's what happens to people who get emotional or who fight the market, they are in a deep process of attachment. And let me tell you something. This is much easier said than done. It requires an awful lot of maturity and introspection, and most importantly, it requires a tremendous amount of self-awareness to understand that, I'm starting to get hot here. I'm starting to get irritated. It's time for me to take my hand off the mouse and go for a walk, go make lunch, go refill my cup of coffee or whatever. Let's break the cycle. And that's, that's the old cue, routine, reward that's covered in The Power of Habit, one of my favorite books by Duhigg. You have to break that cycle, and the only way to break that cycle is to bring light to it in the form of awareness. So if you find that you took a great trade, you wanted to get long in the ES today before this rally up, you took a long and you just put your stop, and that stop happened to be the low of the day, and the market hit your stop, and then it turned around and it ran up 16 points like it did today, you can't attach all this, they're watching me, I am cursed, nobody can do this, it's a lie that people can trade and make money, this is all rigged, this is all for the big guys. None of that is relevant. None of that is relevant. You have to understand that there is a statistical probability that your stop is going to be the high of day or low of day, and it just so happened that time that was your time, And if you look at it from a journaling perspective, you'll find that that occurrence the fact that you caught the entire range of the day or the fact that you got stopped at the high or the low of the day, the occurrence is a lot less significant than your mind thinks it is. And the mind thinks that it happens a lot more often and you're the unlucky guy because you have this strong attachment to wanting every trade to be a winner. And that's what most people do. We did a trader intervention as it's a normal feature of being at stage five. I did a trader intervention on a guy named Michael today on his live results, and I really wanted to impress upon him the fact that how he remembers things, because he's not, the issue he's having really is he's not keeping good track of what's happening. He has this confirmation bias in his mind. He's remembering things not really as they are, and we all do this. We spend a lot of time avoiding the loss. I cannot, as a professional trader, spend all of my time figuring out how I can avoid a loss. For me, I look for a measured loss that is balanced with a profit target for every trade, and my job is to take every trade. If I can manage it a little bit better because I have an insight, maybe the market's not moving in the direction I'm looking for very easily, it's moving in the opposite direction very easily, or size is coming in and pushing the market in the opposite direction, I might use that as a cue to reduce my unit size. I might go from a 48 lot to a 12 lot or a 6 lot, but I still have to take the trade because I know that I cannot attach myself to the fact that my last trade was a loss and so on. Okay, does that make sense? It's really an important topic, and it's really hard to get beyond it, but it's a big part of those people who are struggling to make this happen. It's a big part of the issue is just understanding that what happens right now is really not connected to what happened last time and cannot be connected to what happens in the future, because the past is unchangeable. The future is fabricated. All I can do is focus on what's the trade right now. And saying it is easy, I know, but it's your job is to sit there and really focus your attention on the idea that I have to follow each trade as if it's the first trade of the day. Follow each trade as if it's the first trade of the day, all day, every day.
Wow. What a brilliant answer. That was really, really good. I'm pleased I asked that. And thank you for going into so much detail with that answer. I think that's going to help a lot of people listening to this podcast right now.
I hope so.
One of the other things I wanted to ask you while we're on this subject is, do you have any tips and pointers for how to properly manage periods of drawdown or periods of losing trades where you're sort of on a run of losers and you just really feel like nothing can go right? I know you kind of hit on it there with, not getting attached to the outcome, but how should a trader properly manage a drawdown? And maybe if you could touch on the risk management aspect of that as well.
Okay, that's a really big part of staying in the game. So I could tell you in my career, I've gone through rough patches every single year that I've been a trader. If anybody has ever told you that they come in and they make huge money every day of the year, every year, then you'll want to check that trader's credentials. The fact is, most of the money is made in a short period of time, a short segment of the year. The rest of the year is simply staying afoot with the market so that when that opportunity comes to push, for example, the China correction in August, that big drop, you had to have been in the market and consistently in the market and following the same routine all the time to be able to participate in that in any meaningful way. And part of the process of having, a few short weeks of really, really good trades, good returns, a lot of weeks of just grinding along, kind of making a living just like everybody else. But then there's also that rough patch. We call it the rough patch. And I've had rough patches that have lasted anywhere from 2 weeks to 10 weeks. and they come and go with time. And most of the time, they simply force me to go back to, you know, go back to stage three of competence, what we would call conscious competence. In other words, consciously, deliberately, focusedly following some sort of a plan, or our original plan, or a modified plan to suit the current market conditions. And so the way to manage rough patches is to have an understanding of when one has occurred. And the way you know one has occurred is to look at the streaks that you have. And this is, again, the conversation is always going to go back to really good record keeping. I mean, you're running a business. Just imagine you're running a bakery or an auto dealership or something. It would be crazy to think that you're selling something or you're running a business without some really accurate bookkeeping. Trading is a business, and bookkeeping is a huge part of this business. And so you can always go back and understand that, okay, I recognize a losing streak. As for me, a losing streak is four consecutive down days in a row. And I'm speaking about consecutive down days where I'm actually doing what I'm supposed to do, as opposed to going off the handle and starting to fight the market or something. Those don't count as consecutive down days. It just counts as me being emotional and stupid, which means I need time off. And that's what I force myself to do, is just to detach, just move away. But if I have four down days and I'm following my plan, then it tells me that something has dramatically changed. And so my response to that is to, and I'll go into how I'm managing risk through this process, my response to that is to simply take the following day off. The probability of being down 4 days in a row is what? 0.5, which is a 50% probability of losing, to the power of four. So there's a 6.25% chance that I would have four losing days in a row. So it's like flipping heads four times in a row. So it's 0.5 to the power of 4, or 6.25%. I know that for me to hit that kind of probability, that's almost 2 sigma, or the second standard deviation. I'll back off the statistics a little bit. But for me to hit that, it's pretty hard for me to hit 3 down days in a row. And that's down days meaning I'm down in my P&L plus my cost, plus my daily fixed cost, rent, software, all that stuff broken down on a daily basis. The fifth day, I'm off. I'm not trading the fifth day. The fifth day is me watching the market, doing the homework and everything, watching the market, and I'm spending the day just going through trades from the past, just running through what has happened, pulling up higher time frame charts, and really trying to see, the goal is to see, has something changed dramatically enough in the market to tell me that something's wrong? In fact, last week was one of these weeks where the market was dramatically unusual. We had several days where the market gapped up in a row, gapped up and never closed the gap, and it just continued in the same direction. That's unusual behavior. I didn't have a drawdown during that streak, but it tells me that something, hey, be careful, something has changed. How do I manage the losses or the risk intraday? I use a regressive risk strategy. And so let's say, just for relevance sake, let's say that I generally trade 10 lots in the ES, okay? And if I start out the day and I'm trading 10 lots and I take a trade and I take a loss, and my loss, my daily loss limit, let's say, is $2,000 or $3,000, let's call it $3,000 per day. Okay, which means that my average up day needs to be around $3,000 per day for me to stay in business in the long term. If I reach a third of the way down, then I am cutting my size to 6 contracts. If I get halfway to $3,000 down, then I'm only trading 5. If I get three quarters of the way down, then I'm trading 2. I continue to trade two contracts until I hit that limit. And it's very rare that I hit that loss limit, the daily loss limit. But I want to hit my daily loss limit with the minimum size possible. Now, that's not possible if you're trading one contract, you know, in the futures or a small share size in equities. But my goal is not to make back the $1,500 that I've lost this morning or the $2,500 or whatever. That's not my goal. My focus is not the P&L. It really isn't. It took me a long time to actually be able to accomplish that. But my goal is to find my alignment with the market. I'm going to repeat that. My goal is not to make the money back. My goal is to find my alignment with the market. In other words, get in the zone and get in gear with the market. To find that wave, to be able to recognize that wave that's coming and to be able to paddle my surfboard on top of it and to finally stand and ride that wave back to shore. That's my goal. And I'm not going to be able to do that by insisting on trading 10 lots and 10 lots and 10 lots and taking losses and then, boom, five losses, five trades on a 10 lot and I'm out $3,000 and I have to stop for the day. That's not going to help me. What I want to do is hit that $3,000 loss limit with my smallest size possible. Because if I can't accomplish that with two contracts to where I can find my alignment and start building my account back up with a series of really good positive trades, then I'm not giving myself enough sample size or enough samples of trades to be able to find that alignment. So imagine the opposite. Imagine if you traded 10 lots and you have a $3,000 limit for the day before you have to stop for the day. Imagine if I go halfway through and I lose $1,500 and then all of a sudden I put on a 20 lot trade and that 20 lot trade wipes away the rest of the $1,500. Okay, so out of the $3,000 I was able to participate in the market twice with two trades. Two trades is not nearly enough to show me that something's wrong or my plan doesn't have an edge. My goal is to maximize it. If I'm gonna give away $3,000, I need to do it with as large number of trades as possible, because what happens is eventually I start to find what the market is looking to do. I start to find alignment. And as I cross, if I get down from zero to $1,500 to $2,500 to $2,800, and all of a sudden I find myself from $2,800 down on two contracts, I start to come up to $2,000. Okay, I'm back to four contracts. I get to down $1,500, I'm up to six contracts or five contracts. Now I have alignment, and now I can start building that position back up. I have the confidence to push those trades or to take the trades that are paying off. I've found the edge again, and I'm building back up. And to me, every other way I've tried for myself and my traders has not worked. I've had traders use a constant, you know, doesn't matter how far you're down, just keep trading the same size. Boop, 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 boop. And most of the time they just limit out for the day and, you know, the account's locked and they're done for the day. What I do is I regress. I look for a regression in the amount I'm trading, and my goal is to create as many opportunities to read the market, to trade the market and read the market as possible. And I know that most people don't do that. But that, if I hit 3 days in a row on limit using that method, something is dramatically going wrong. It really is. And if you're trading one or two lots, just start out with your two lots halfway to your limit. Let's say your limit's, you know, $600. You've lost $300 on your two lots. Switch to one lots and get really picky about your trades. Just find the trades that you are most confident in, that you have the highest probabilities on, and stake your one lot on that, and it should give you about four trades before you lose the entire amount. What you don't want to do is take your two lot trade, lose $600 on one trade for the day, and that is it. That is a very binary way to lose money. And my intent always in trading is to get the most, to make the market work as hard as possible to take my money away, if it will take my money away, and it often does. But I want to do it on as many trades as possible. I want to do it fighting not the market, but I want to do it fighting the probabilities, fighting the negative probability, finding that positive probability, the alignment with the market. I hope that makes sense.
Yeah, absolutely. One of the things I did want to ask you before we wrap this up here, and I actually wanted to ask you about it last time, but we sort of ran out of time then. Also, just a couple questions around brokerage. You know, you're obviously the right man to ask. So, you know, when starting out, opening a brokerage account can be somewhat of a daunting task. What are a few things that people should take into consideration before deciding on a broker?
Okay, so even though I'm affiliated with a brokerage, the brokerage is a way for me to fulfill a vision. And eventually I want to get back to prop using the brokerage, being able to vet people out through the brokerage. That's my goal. So my comments are not going to be from the perspective, you know, take it or leave it, not from the perspective of, hey, come to stage five trading, we are the best of the best. That's not the goal. What I want to say is, you want to be with a brokerage that, one, gives you the largest, as big a number of solutions to whatever trading method or software that you want to use as possible. Stage 5 trading is an independent introducing broker. In other words, we have relationships with multiple clearing firms providing many, many, many different types and combinations of software, and our brokers are trained to be able to find what it is you're trying to do and to match you up with the lowest cost solution that actually fulfills your need. You know, keeping costs down, especially at the beginning, is quite important. So we want you to connect with a piece of software that gives you the data that you need without having to pay additionally for data, or to give you the software that you need, the charts that you need, without having to pay additionally for charts. And sometimes you have to pay for additional charts because of the features that you're looking for. So having a broker with a vast number of outlets for solutions is important. The big thing about brokerage, and I wish they would change this at the exchange level, is the fact that people are out there advertising $400 or $300 per contract margins. That is just 8% or 7% of the required exchange margin in futures. Okay, so for the S&P, the required exchange margin is around $5,000. And that, the $5,000, is really 1 to 20 leverage compared to the value of the S&P 500. So you're already getting a lot of leverage with the exchange margin. And then you have these brokers out there that are giving you 10 times that. So 200 to 1 leverage. And what that leverage is doing, and people see that advertised everywhere, and so they think it's important that somehow they have to have $500 margins. We don't want to do that. We have access to that in certain circumstances, and I manage risk for Stage 5 as well as monitor traders. There have to be some really exceptional circumstances, some experience, a lot of experience, or you know, good streaks or something that would merit someone getting that much leverage. But we want to de-lever people. We want you to trade at 50% of required margins. We want you to slow down. That's the thing that most brokers don't do, and I think eventually they will. We want you to slow down. We don't want you to trade a 10 lot on a $5,000 account. You're going to kill yourself within a week or two. And it's a waste of your time. It's a waste of your money. It's a waste of our time. And it's a lost opportunity for everybody, including the trader. We want to avoid that. We think that's a disaster. It's kind of like handing a child a loaded gun. It's the outcome is not likely to be good. So a broker who's concerned about you and understands traders and trading should be helping you manage your risk. And that's what we do best, I believe, on a best effort basis. We want to give you the tools to help manage your risk. We want to de-lever you. We want you to start slow. You know, $500 margins benefit the broker. Every broker wants you to come in and trade 10 lots and trade and trade and trade and churn, because they get paid. A broker only gets paid when you trade live. So they want to give you as much buying power as possible. I'm not interested in making money off of traders right now. I'm interested in a longer-term relationship, which includes the process of being in this community. It's very important for me to have quality traders as part of our chat community, our weekly webinar community, and helping us build a sustainable long-term business. And a lot of traders who, you know, start out trying to trade, but their job gets in the way. It gives us an opportunity to put them in our, you know, S&P automated trading system, a professionally created trading system, or to invest their money in managed programs, managed funds that are fully regulated, fully transparent, things like that. I want to mention that, you know, investing in futures is not suitable for everybody, but at the same time, we want to make sure we slow someone down. So if you have a broker who is very anxious to quote you a commission, to give you your login and password, and that broker is gone, and they're not doing anything for you, they're not informing you, they're not helping you trade better, they're not intervening, this is a typical structure that I see in our industry, and this is what we're changing. We want it to be a more personal thing. I name anyone in the chat room out of 200 some odd people that are in there on a daily basis, out of more than 2,000 accounts, I'm able to tell you something about that person. I'm able to tell you what their general performance issues are. You know, are they chatty? Are they not focused? Are they focused? This is what we want. We want more and more of a community-based structure. And if your broker can offer that, great. If they can't, stage five is ready and willing, you know. Not to sound like a commercial, but that's an important thing for me. And that's, by the way, is what is available to professionals. When I went and started my prop shop at Advantage Futures when they first started in 2004, that's what I got. I got the senior VP making sure he knew who I was, knew the names of every one of my traders, made sure that I got the best pricing I could, and made sure we're comfortable while we rented office space within their office, had the best connections possible, had the best servers possible. It's you really build loyalty, and now all you need to focus on is the market rather than, you know, could I get a commission somewhere else? Could I get better margins somewhere else? Maybe I can squeeze my broker for 5 cents or 10 cents. It's irrelevant. If you're hemorrhaging thousands of dollars every day because you don't know how to manage your risk, what difference is 5 cents or 10 cents going to make in your commission structure? It makes no sense. But that's what everybody's focus is on, because that's what everybody in the industry is advertising. Better commissions, and lower margins. But in the grand scheme of things, if you want to be a professional, those seem like a priority, but they're not.
Mm-hmm. So one of the things I'd just like you to clarify and sort of make us clear on is you describe stage five as an independent introducing broker. How does that differ from a typical retail broker, you know, someone like E-Trade or, you know, just to name a name?
Okay, so let's take E-Trade, TD Ameritrade, or Thinkorswim. They are, for one, offering you a large number of services. So think of, I know this doesn't exist anymore, and I'm dating myself a little bit. Think of going to America Online or Prodigy or CompuServe to get an internet connection. What you're plugging into is a service that is built around giving you as much, providing you with as much as possible internally, and then giving you market access. Whereas if you go with an independent broker, you're generally getting direct market access. Someone like TradeStation, for example, has options, has futures, has Forex, or they don't have Forex anymore, actually, and has equities. And they're not exceptional at any one of those, but they're giving you all of those outlets. I would not go to Thinkorswim or E-Trade or Scottrade or Ameritrade as a professional. I would go direct. I would be seeking, if I'm trading futures, I would want to go with a futures broker, a direct broker. If I'm trading equities, I would want to go with a direct equities broker, and so on and so forth. That's really the difference. The connection you get from an IIB or an independent broker is not focused on what service can I get you to be aligned with so that I can sell you on the service that I have. So that's, I am forcing you to fit what I'm offering, okay? And in general, much of what happens after the account's opened is automated. You call because you're stuck in a position, you get a computer that walks you through the process and so on. With us, it is, we tailor the service to you. It's, we're going in the opposite direction. So if Aaron wants to come in and he, someone who has used CQG Trader and wants to power his, you know, multi-charts using CQG, I'm not going to sit here and say, no, you'll have to use our Thinkorswim platform, and that's it. I am going to get you the CQG Trader, the same environment, the same charts, and I'm going to make it work for you at the best possible cost. That's what your broker should be doing, as opposed to forcing you to align yourself with what I have to offer. Because it's hard enough to trade. It's hard enough to align yourself with the market. Now you have to learn a new platform and you have to learn a new process and figure out how to get your charts to look the way they did. That's not what we do. We just reach out to as many vendors as possible, as many clearing firms as possible, and try to provide the solution. If we don't, our brokers are required to basically say, we can't do it, we're sorry, but here's the number of someone who can. Even if we don't make money on it, you're off on your way to getting what you need. You need to have access to equities, plus Forex, plus futures. Well, we're a futures-only broker. Here's where you should probably go, you know, and that's really the difference, as opposed to a giant kind of organization that has already set its course, kind of like a big ship, and it's hard for it to turn with the technology and what's being offered. It's hard for it to integrate that until much, much later. We are very malleable because we're small. We have access to all these pieces, and we don't own or maintain any of the software. It's someone else's software. We just make it available to you. That's all.
Very good. Very good. Okay. All right. Well, let's wind this down. So FT, where is the best place to go if a listener wants to find out more about you?
So you can find me online at futurestrader71.com. Hit the contact link and drop me a note. If I can help you, I'd be happy to do it. And the otherwise, you can find me on Twitter. Just go to twitter.com/futurestrader71 or at futurestrader71. And, you know, I'm participating in there all day long, every day while the market's open. And as always, if I can guide you in the right direction, great. If I can't, then I'll let you know.
Awesome, awesome. No, I appreciate that. I noticed you just had the website redone recently. It's looking good.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks. It's a slow process to redo those websites, but this one's a lot more friendly, I hope.
Yeah, no doubt. All right, man. Well, it's been awesome to have you back on again. Really incredible insights. So thank you very much for taking the time to share with us.
Always a pleasure, and I really appreciate your broadcast. I think it's probably helped more people than you think you have.
I appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Take care. Bye.
You've come to the end of this episode of Chat with Traders, but don't worry, more great episodes are on the way. To stay updated with each great new episode, be sure to subscribe to the podcast in iTunes, and we'd love it if you leave us a rating and review. We'll see you next time on Chat with Traders.